Welcome back to another episode of Raise 'Em Up. We are walking through one of my favorite books, a book that's really greatly influenced me and my ministry, The Spiritually Vibrant Home by Don Everts. And we got through our introduction last time, but now we get to kind of dive into chapter one, which the title is Recognizing the Spiritual Significance of the Mundane. All right, so you guys, initial thoughts just in general on chapter one. And for me, at least, this book does such a great job of step-by-step making me more refreshed than I'm reading it, right? So I appreciate the conversation more and more each step of the way along the way. What about you guys? As you dive into this chapter about talking about the spiritual significance of the mundane, which some of our listeners are going to be like, I need you to unpack that word for me. What are your initial thoughts as you look at this chapter?
So everything that happens in our house is important. Even the little things like playing a board game.
Absolutely.
With my kid because she's bored. I mean, just everything that we do, those dinners when I force my children who are, teenagers to come down and sit around the table and mm-hmm. we do our highs and lows every mm-hmm. day. Those things that we do all the time, those are important. Just the things that you don't think about that are just kind of part of what you do.
Exactly. And I think one of the big takeaways of this chapter, and we'll look at it a little deeper when we get there, though, is this idea that I would say community, connection, and relationships matter. And I don't think that's a surprise to us, but that's one of the big hearts of this, particularly the relationship that you have with those who live in your home, right?
Yeah, I like this chapter just because it highlights something that I think we get backwards a lot, which is that we try to carve out holy time, special time, that's God time or spiritual time. And one of the quotes in this chapter is basically saying, if my whole life is supposed to be devoted to Christ, then I have to reconcile the fact that that means when I'm doing the dishes or when we're cleaning the house or when I'm taking my kids to their soccer practice or whatever, that is also something that is dedicated to Christ. So it kind of like sanctifies the mundane moments. It sets them apart for God instead of saying, here's my God time and here's my home time. It's God, here's my time and here's my home.
I love that. Yeah, and especially, again, that mundane. Again, so unpacking mm-hmm. that word for anybody that needs it. Like that doing the dishes, folding the clothes, making
the boring,
my bed.
Boring, everyday tasks,
driving
waking
in
up
the car,
those kids that are, hesitant to get out of bed and, yeah.
Exactly, breakfast. Every moment matters. And to some extent, I would imagine, I say that and some parents' heart just tensed up, right? Because it's like, oh no, every moment matters. But it's not meant to make you stress out. It's actually meant to expand your understanding mm-hmm. of the reach that God has and the places where God has always intended to go. Mm-hmm. I mean, you go back, let's go a little theological on it. And when I say theological, I mean, just God thought, that's what that word means, and particularly scriptural, and go to Genesis chapter 2. You have the creation of the world. And then how does God want to relate to the creation that he has? He walks with it in mm-hmm. the garden, in the cool of the day. He's with it all the time. There wasn't a set, place and time.
Mm-hmm.
That
hour
that's where
a week.
It went. Yeah. And that's why I really appreciate, Melanie, what you said about it's not about setting apart this holy time and that's where formation happens. Every moment matters. Every conversation mm-hmm. matters. Every word that we say, the way that we relate to each other matters.
Yeah, it makes me think of the Last Supper when Jesus washes the disciples' feet. Like of all the mundane tasks, but he did it in someone's house, which is kind of what we're talking about
exactly.
this week. He did it in someone's house. And it was something that the disciples could have said in the grand scheme of his ministry was completely worthless. But he saw this act of service to the people that he loved as absolutely crucial to the way that they would understand his love. And so, as you're doing the dishes, as you're packing your kids' lunch, like you can understand and see that God cares about those things because he cares about washing the feet of people.
Yeah.
He cares about serving people. And so if Jesus took time to do the lowest of the low tasks and he did it for those that he cared about, that he welcomed into a home, we can understand that our daily mundane tasks are also important and can be a vessel of love.
It was about 5 years ago when I think the idea of time and how we spend it hit me so hard because it was the first time I could remember as a parent that I drove to work without my kids in the car because they always came to school where I worked. So I remember that first week. It was just brutal for me. It was so quiet, and I thought so many mornings those first couple of weeks about how many mornings did I waste this 11 minutes, right? Huh. It takes us 11 minutes to get to work. Mm-hmm. How many weeks or mornings did I just drive here quietly, or did I have the radio on? Was I always listening to them? Like, to me, that car time with your kids when they're yours in your car, gosh, just it's like so valuable, and it's so impactful and so meaningful, and we don't always plug into it, you know?
It's interesting you knew the exact time, right? Yeah. 11 minutes. And so I think about that. Chances are if you're going 11 minutes one way, you got 11 minutes another way. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so all of a sudden you've got 22 minutes in a day, right, and you go that 5 days a week, you've got over 100
36
minutes.
36 a week, you know? 36 weeks a year.
Crazy.
Yeah.
Crazy the amount of time that we get. And so I kind of, before we started, I kind of said, like, it's every church worker's dream that this kind of understanding, it's not even this kind of discipleship, but this kind of understanding of God's presence would permeate every single person that we serve. Because there's some extent that there's a huge conversation in the church right now about how consumeristic we've become. And I think another word for it, especially using your setting aside the time, setting apart holy time, how compartmentalized we've made everything in our lives, particularly faith. And there's an extent, and I was actually just downstairs talking to our senior pastor about a church that I heard in February 2020, the conference right before the pandemic, that just rocked me of their approach to ministry. They have a youth person, they have a kids ministry person, but they don't have regular program stuff like we think of. It's not a come here during this time on this day to do this. It's very much a resourcing families and homes to live out discipleship where they're at. Because I would imagine there's people, and I don't want to take away at all from the time that we get to gather together as community. I think that is so crucial and so valuable for the bigger household, which we'll get into in future chapters, a biblical perspective of that, to come together. That's huge. That's critical. That is testified in scripture for sure. And I don't want to take away from the importance of a Bible class and the opportunity we have to learn in a group setting with people outside of our household. But I think there's plenty of families out there that genuinely want to engage their family in discipleship, genuinely want to have their families learn about God, learn what it means to pray, learn what it means to ask good questions and things like that, but cannot find the time, can't carve that time out.
Right.
And then what happens? Guilt.
Yeah.
Yes.
Shame.
Yeah.
I can't do this. I didn't make this happen. I'm failing as a parent. All these different things can run into your brain. And all this to say, parent who's thinking that, you're normal, right?
Right. Yeah.
And here's the other great news of this chapter in particular. It's not those things that has the end-all, be-all say over your kid's faith growing up.
Yes.
It's actually every moment, every opportunity, as you've heard us say, no matter what it is that you get with your kids, you know, again, washing dishes, driving in the car, family time together, and finding ways to actually just relate and be together. And that's where you end up finding some spiritual vibrancy.
I think that was kind of a gift early in the pandemic, right? Was that we were kind of forced to that. So when I was reading this chapter, a lot of the things that I highlighted were things that I remember early on to be so excited about. Like, I have this time and space with my kids home, not really competing. You know, we didn't have any competition about who was going where, what was more important, what won out on the calendar. You know, all of that stuff had kind of faded away for those few months. And I reveled in that. You know, I was like, this is what I want my home to look like all the time.
Exactly.
But then there was this battle as things started getting back on the calendar is, you know, why aren't we still doing what we were reveling in just 3 short months ago, right? Like now there's competition back on the calendar of everybody's going their different directions instead of sitting down and doing these things that we had really become accustomed to and all reported we loved, right? Even the kids were like, I love that.
Exactly.
So I think sometimes this chapter reminded me that it's our own choosing about what gets competition time on the calendar, you know, because our homes can be those places that are distraction free if we set them up that way. But it's just hard to do as a parent with active kids moving in different directions, whether your kids are 2 and 3 or 21 and 18, you
exactly.
know?
I think that's a good transition to the start of the chapter too. Of you said how we set up our homes. And so like what's interesting is you said that was you read this and you go back to the start of the pandemic. But as I mentioned in the introduction to this book, right. I read this in June of 2020. This book came out in
before.
2020. Mm. And I read this as the pandemic was starting. And I think that's why I'm so convicted by what it lays out for us. Yeah. And I'm telling you, like the, particularly the next chapter, I'm doing the same thing.
Yeah. Words. I think because we just came from chapel.
Exactly. So, but particularly this next chapter is going to super convict you because, I mean, I think whenever people ask me about like Christian in general, but Lutheran denominations, right?
Right.
What's important for Lutherans? I still remember being a camp director and my first year as camp director, great family that like their kid is now a counselor at the camp, but he was 5 when I met him, right? And they're like, so tell me about this Lutheran thing. I was like, well, we really focus in on Jesus and the grace that he shows for us. And we love the Bible. And so, and we all laugh
things,
because
right?
you go to the themes of the Reformation. One of them is word alone, right?
Yeah.
So scripture alone. And the next chapter is going to go hard at scripture and show us how significant the household is in scripture. Mm. And it is so convicting and so refreshing. But going back to Tracy, where you were at, how you set up your home is so important. So this chapter begins with a really humorous conversation of Don, when he and his wife were first married, he goes into the kitchen and sees like some piece of recycling in the trash. And he like kind of gets angry with his wife and says, in this house, we recycle.
Yeah.
Which like all of you guys who are married would know, terrible way to start. Terrible way to start. Don't be so demanding and things like that. But he kind of uses this to unpack how significant how we organize our homes tells us about our values.
Right.
You know, so again, it's similar. When we read the book Sticky Faith, there was a really convicting chapter about sticky faith conversations that started the chapter by saying, what if we had a microphone in your house?
Yeah.
What would it tell us about you as a family? But it's the same thing as if I were to walk into your house, what would that tell you about? Tell me, what would that tell me about your family?
Mm. And priorities.
Exactly.
Priorities,
yeah. So actually it was really funny. Like when I was, I'm still in the first house I've ever bought. And I remember the house hunting and there was a layer to which that was very convicting for me too of what mattered to me. And I think if you saw my house, you can tell what mattered to me. And I always kind of joked, like actually I remember posting on Facebook about it and saying, I'd like to thank my dog Sully for the choice in house because I wanted a big backyard like with grass, you know, because I was going to have a dog and then like that was a given, right? Or I had a dog at that time, but I always thought about that. And it needed to be big because it was going to be an active dog and Spartacus is an active dog too. And like running around and things like that was going to be important. But the other thing for my house, I'm one of those ones that likes a small house. So even like if and when that day comes that I have a family, I want us to interact. I don't want us to be in our rooms. I don't want us to have TVs in every room. And I'm not judging anybody that does.
No.
I just know like that can distract us and silo us and things like that. Mm. And so when you walk into my house, like I loved it the first time I walked in because it is a giant living room for a small house and a kitchen that is open. Like you can see everything, that open concept idea. And there's one little hallway that goes back to the bedrooms. But it means if we want to spend time together or if you want to be in the house, you're going to be spending time together.
Right.
And it's true whenever my family comes to visit. It's no fun. I mean, maybe if you need to go rest, you go to the bedroom or whatever, but you can still hear everybody. And so you know they're
you
all
know what
having
you're
fun
missing out
and
on.
They're talking. Yeah.
Right.
And so we spend a whole lot of time in there or we go out into the big backyard, you know? So like how you set up your home tells me a lot about who you are and your values as a family.
Right. They were even talking about, you know, when you go shopping, when you're setting up your home and you go to Home Depot, right? And you're picking out all the things for your house. I mean, those little things that you don't even pay any attention to as you're setting up.
Right.
This is kind of setting the tone for your house, for your, you know, the people that are going to be coming in and visiting, the people that are living there. Even
I think if we think back to our growing up with siblings, we can think that's true then too. Like we can see how that kind of shaped the way we were in our homes. You know, I always shared a room with siblings. And so it was easy for me to embrace that with my kids. We had plenty of extra rooms. I have 2 daughters and they always shared a room until probably about junior high. And then they started saying, there's enough rooms, you go get your own, you know? But as they were little, that was like part of we share this. It's a common space.
Sure. And the lessons learned there.
Right. And I think that, you know, that that common area, whether it be shared spaces for kids or shared spaces as a living area, those are the places that a lot of, it's like the heart of your home, which seems kind of cliche to say, but it really is where that those bonds happen.
I was actually recounting recently, like someone in the, I think it was somebody on staff, like their husband maybe had a triple bunk bed in their house growing up. I was like, my dad did too.
Yeah.
Because I remember going to my grandparents and there's this triple bunk bed that my grandpa had built. And so we would stay there. The top bunk was filled with storage stuff because like all of the moms were like, my kid is not staying on the top bunk. So like, okay, we'll put all the storage
too
stuff
tall.
There. But then what's interesting now is as a grown man walking into this room, I'm like, how in the world did a triple bunk bed and a queen bed fit in this room,
one room
for us to stay when we were growing up? But myself, like I have two brothers and the three of us shared a room all the way until I was a freshman in high school. And that's when we were able to like let my sister always had her own room because she was the girl.
The only girl.
And so like we were able to convert our guest room, which was really a storage room, into a room for her. And my older brother got her room so he could have more space his senior year of high school. Well, slowly but surely, it was kind of fun going like once he transitioned into college and I was getting a little older, I was like, you know, well, Tom's like off at college. Like, so,
I can have the room.
Maybe I can have my own room too. But I agree with you completely on that. Yeah. You learn to share. You learn what it means to interact. And not just share in the sense of space and respect of other people's things, but also you can't hide when things are bad. You know, you learn conversation, you learn all these other things. Now, notice, friends that are listening, we haven't talked about Jesus yet. We haven't talked about prayer. We haven't talked about reading scripture. But this idea of community, which is a theological basis, right? In the creation of Eve, God said it's not good for man to be alone. We are meant to be in community. In the Trinity, we see God himself is in community, three persons in one. So there's this level to which that's really cool for all of us too. Now, to kind of step on in, oh, there was one quote though to wrap that piece up. I loved, people always make domestic decisions based on deeper values. So how you do life, I mean, it's similar to what Jesus says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You know, where you spend your money, how you spend your time, how you set up your space, like all of those allocations tell me so much about you and your family, you know, if I were to be able to observe. But Melanie, a point that you kind of brought up early was kind of the heart of the chapter too, and then it dove deeper into how convicting it is what Jesus did. So you mentioned like Jesus in the upper room. When you look at Jesus' ministry, and this is what's so cool about this, and again, it only get deeper in the next chapter, but Jesus executes his ministry through homes. Every time.
And he, I mean, he does visit the synagogues. He does, you know, preach in the countryside. But he chooses not to, you know, bring a tent along and stay, you know, on his own, but he goes and he visits homes. And, you know, I think about the paralytic man that was put through the roof of the home, like that happened at a home. He visited Peter's, you know, mother-in-law at her home, and
Mary and Martha's daughter. Look at this. I mean, do you see this? Like, we're going all around of every
and
single
really impactful
moment
stories.
And he told his disciples, go to people's homes as he sent them out on mission, you know, go to their homes. And he expected hospitality because, yes, it was a Jewish value, but it's a Jewish value because it was from the heart of God that we should be in community. You know, I think about a Bible study that I was at recently, and it was a group of young moms, and we were talking about what kind of homes we have, and whether our personalities were a bit more ordered, or you know, are you a filer or a piler? You know, are you more messy and whatever goes, or are you kind of neat and stored away? And ultimately, we got to this question of like, how hard is it to have people over? And it was really refreshing to talk to people about how, like, I hosted a Bible study for a while, and you know, I felt like people thought that my house was clean and they enjoyed coming there, but I was getting tired of leading the Bible study and, you know, hosting every time. And so I decided that maybe if I let the veil down a little bit and I just let my house get a little bit messier and a little bit messier, maybe that would encourage other people to not be so worried about hosting there. Because if I let my house get a little bit messy and let people over and don't have a problem with it, and sure enough, that's what happened. You know, over time, in this situation, they just are like, hey, come on in. It's messy. It doesn't really... And so that's a value too, you know, that I'm okay with, with chaos, or I'm okay with clutter. And I'm okay with people seeing me not on.
Yes.
And I say that in quotes, so, you know, like not on all the time.
Real life.
Real life. Yeah. Yeah.
What our kids are craving for too. If you loud have anybody messy, in Gen right? Z, if yep, you have any millennials. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Well, and I think when you think of your house, right? That's yeah. the place where you can go and be you.
Yes.
Right. And let down. Because yeah. I think with society and even at church, right? Some people feel like you've got to put on this mask of perfection and my family is perfect and we all, everybody's mm-hmm. sitting here so nicely yeah. in our pew doing the right thing. And you come to my house and there are backpacks on the couch and there are shoes oh, yeah. on the floor and there's dog hair and bunny hair rolling around on the floor because that's just how our house mm-hmm. is. My yeah. girls are coming, they're going.
That's who
and
we are.
Right?
Yeah.
yeah. But it's that's what our house is. And so when people come over, at first, mm-hmm. you know, once my girls were old enough to start leaving their stuff everywhere, when they were younger, I was constantly picking up after right. them, right? Now they're older, and I'm like, okay, yeah. no. Yeah. But at first, when people would come over, I'd be like, I'm so sorry. you yeah. know, here, yeah. let me pick this stuff up. Now it's like, you know what, this is our life. This yeah. is this yeah. is where we live. This is how we live.
And I think on some level, too, it's good to model that for kids. As Absolutely. You're raising yep. kids up, you know, I just think there's such value in showing them that things are not always exactly what they look like. So if you go to somebody's house and it looks spotless and you come home and our house is a little unkept, it doesn't mean that their mom is more on it right. than your mom. It means that, you know, life was a little messy this week and it's okay, you
and
know?
It's funny, as you guys are talking, I'm like, feeling seen a little bit because my grow group, I host my grow group along with my co-leader and like I will clean up and mm-hmm. I don't think it's because I'm afraid of them seeing my house dirty, but there's that level of hospitality.
I want them to be comfortable.
Well. Yeah. I want them to have a pleasant experience. Like there is a layer to which I've kind of said, like, I would love to have staff people over to my house, but there's a layer to which I'm like, I live in Spring and Klein and we're in oil country and all this other stuff. Like, come over to my house is a little humbling right. for everybody maybe, but it's like, I'm happy. I'm good with it. I'm not afraid of it. I'm not ashamed of it. But it's like, there's that level too of like,
sure.
just well, the balance between the two of them.
Sure. Your colleagues that are Lutheran teachers feel that on a real level.
There is no doubt.
Because, you know, our kids go to school here yeah. where, you know, their friends and their peers are living in certain ways that our salaries as Lutheran church workers aren't yeah. affording us,
yeah.
right? And that's a process. I'm sure your girls went through it as well. I mean, mm-hmm. my kids were coming through here in the, you know, the first half of the 2000s, you know, 2008, 9, 10, 11, they were here at Trinity mm-hmm. learning those hard lessons when, you know, we would have people over and they would say, oh, your house is so sweet and small, you know, and it'd be like, oh, thanks, you know.
No.
And cry when they leave.
And, you know, like my kids were like, God, I think our house is big. We have 5 bedrooms and only 2 kids. Like,
oh,
what do we
wow.
do with all these
yeah,
bedrooms,
no
you
kidding.
Know? But then it's like a reality check for like how other people live versus how you live and how personal, when you go back to the
oh,
first chapter,
yeah,
how like
nature
that home stuff and family stuff just really feels personal. So when you have to teach your kids to love your home, not your house.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of Lutheran teachers or Christian church workers or, you know, lower income people in a higher income area probably miss that distinction sometimes. That it's not that kids want to be at your house. It's that kids feel comfortable coming to your home.
Yeah.
And that
yeah.
kind of segues into some of those things that they talked about in the chapter on page, I think, 22 or 24, where they listed the qualities.
Oh, 21.
Like those, nowhere on there is it large home,
fancy,
or
pristine,
or even like you know, custom home with sliding doors and
right,
things like
right.
that. Right? Like it's yeah. it's just, is your house comfortable? Is it loving? Well, is it nurturing?
And
is it
I think
safe?
That's it. I think it's how do they feel when they come over, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because
right.
that's what my husband and I always said whenever our girls were younger. I was like, I want our house to be the one that our kids want to bring their friends to,
right?
Right? I want them to come hang out here.
Right.
Not because I think
the coolest things or the best things.
And we certainly don't because, again, church worker.
Right.
A school teacher, even before that. I mean, yes. No.
Yeah.
But I wanted it to be the place where they were comfortable coming and knowing they were safe and loved.
Right.
And we do see some of that. My children for sure have friends who have, you know, more of things or, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. But they come to our house and they have no problem just knocking on the door and opening the door and coming in, or even, you know, coming if my kids aren't there, if they need a place, right? Mm-hmm. If we're closer to something, hey, you know, can so-and-so come hang out for a little while? Sure.
And it kind of touches on that consumerism. Like, it's hard to not talk about homes without talking about that, you know, that's part of our materialistic life in society.
Well, so that's what, when you guys were talking, I'm obviously an English major. I'm a little bit of a nerd. But like Harry Potter, I relate it deeply as a kid reading book two when you get to go over to the burrow at the Weasleys. And the Weasleys, Ron is super embarrassed because the Weasleys don't have so much. But Harry loves it. Hermione loves it. Hermione's a little bit
connected.
From a more affluent place. Yes. And they love this place because of the family experience. The mess doesn't matter. The realness is what matters. And that's true for everybody. Okay, cool. You have a great, fancy, clean house, but if there's not love, I mean, you go 1 Corinthians 13 a little bit on that without love. And that's what, like, for those that are listening to, maybe if they haven't engaged the book, page 21 is important. Of the top words that are used by spiritually vibrant homes, the people that they discovered, what were the words they used? Number one, comfortable. Number two, loving. Number three, safe. Number four, peaceful. Number five, casual. Number six, joyful. Number seven, playful. Number eight, nurturing. Number nine, old fashioned. Number 10, intellectual.
But that was only 25%. That's just top 10.
But that's top 10. Your top 10 have nothing to do with stuff. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's really
just
how do you relate? How are you in community?
And I wonder there if the old fashioned is a kind of pseudonym for just unplugged. Right.
Yes, like, absolutely.
Because, you know, I mean, I don't know what the thinking was in the survey there, but certainly when my kids talk about old fashioned things, it's usually unplugged things, right?
Yeah, not the latest and greatest.
Right. Unconnected.
You know what this is saying? This is about the routines, the activities, and the relationships.
Yeah.
Right? This is that's what it is. It's not the stuff, it's not the time, it's not the activities, it's the routine. Like the stuff you do every single day, the activities and how you relate to each other. I mean, that's the significance. And just kind of going back to the heart of the chapter, the central, not just the central place where Jesus did his ministry, but his teaching. Like, look at the way that he teaches, the things that he talks about are all using words about the home, because we all understand home. Ultimately, when they're organizing the early church, Paul, when he's talking to Timothy about, hey, here's a way to determine leaders, what's the list that he uses? He uses a list about how are they running their home. Like, that's how we should determine whether or not leaders are fit to run the community or help lead a community, is how are they relating in the home. The significance of the conversion of Saul to Paul.
Yeah.
Like, I think we think of the conversion, for those not familiar with it, it's Book of Acts. You have Saul, who was a persecutor of the church, who killed Christians, who is a really great Jew, who was going after the Christians because it was to a Jewish person, if you don't see Jesus for who he is, then he's a blasphemer, right? Mm-hmm. He's committing the ultimate sin, even in the eyes of the Jewish faith. But eventually Saul gets converted, and it's on the road, and you have this great conversion experience where Jesus is there, he's blinded, you know, and things like that. And we think, oh, that's it. You know, that's why Saul's conversion to Paul was so significant, because he was blinded by Jesus Christ. I mean, how would you not forget that? And by doing that, we neglect what happened next.
Mm-hmm. All the unpacking.
Yeah. Yeah. All the way unpacking the discipleship that happened when he went to the home of, I don't think I'm making it up, Ananias. And he's sitting there, and Ananias is kind of terrified because he's like, this is Saul. Like, you're going to bring Saul into my household. Right. But what do? They spend weeks together, weeks unpacking what it is that Jesus did, discipleship, and he's welcomed with hospitality. They live together in order to learn. It's not, hey, Saul, because we're a little terrified of you, you're going to go stay over here.
On the outskirts.
At 8 a.m., come meet up over here, and we'll go till lunchtime, and then we'll lunch break. And then, no, they live together in the home, and that's where discipleship is really learned, because how you treat every single moment matters.
Yeah.
There's, I don't know how many of you have seen The Chosen, and I love it for a few different reasons. It certainly is not fully biblical. It's, you know,
I'm sure people, with, so oh, the, anybody that doesn't,
yeah,
know what
anybody
the
who doesn't
is,
know what The yeah. Chosen is, it's a fully crowdfunded TV series about the life of Jesus, and it uses the framework of the Gospels and some of the moments of the Gospels and a lot of the language of Jesus and his disciples and their conversations, but it just kind of fills in some gaps artistically with. You know, it's just some interpretations of like, what would a day with Jesus really have been like? What would his interactions have looked like with people? And there's this scene, and it's not in scripture, and this is for all you single people out there, all of you who are not talking about the families and having kids over and, you know, or even the way you and your spouse are setting up your home. But there's this scene where we see the Mary Magdalene character inviting a bunch of other single people or other people who are kind of marginalized in the mm-hmm, community mm-hmm. to come to her home to celebrate the Sabbath. And then Jesus shows up and he spends the Sabbath with her. And he's not in charge of it. He doesn't, you know, preside over all of the traditions. And he says, this is your home. I would be honored if you would lead it. And he just participates and is present with her. And again, not in the Bible, but I loved what it showed that there was, that Jesus values the hospitality, not just that you give to your family, but that you as an individual give to the people around you by welcoming them into your home and inviting them into relationship with God. And that God is honored even if you're not confident in leading the prayers.
All right,
God
that's
is,
a big one.
God is honored even when you aren't sure you're saying the exact right thing, but you in your heart, you are inviting people in and you are showing them respect and showing them love. And I just, it gave me chills watching that scene. Again, not from the Bible, but I loved the heart of it.
Yeah.
You could imagine it.
Yeah. You that's where Jesus is. Yeah. You
right.
don't have to be
right.
a pro.
Don't have to be
you
a
don't
pro.
Have, and this could be your very first time.
And every pro started like that.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, yeah.
And I think that's what I enjoyed most about this chapter mm-hmm. is that it kind of shows you that, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's not about, you know, every conversation you have with someone, you're throwing in a bit of Jesus.
Right.
It's not about
right.
your biblical knowledge and that you pray and you sound like, you know, the pastor at church on Sunday.
Right.
It's about living your life in a way
that honors God.
That honors God.
And yeah. shows and Jesus, right?
Yeah. Like, right.
In
by
love.
The
what
things
we
that
right.
you
right.
do, mm-hmm. not necessarily how you say it and how beautiful it sounds.
Yeah.
And, right.
And your house doesn't have to look like the heart of Jesus, pristine no. and clean and whatever. Your house just has to show you that Jesus has an effect on your heart.
Right.
Right? So like I invite people into my mess because Jesus came into my mess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
And I am vulnerable and open about my
you.
Failing
yeah. Yeah.
because Jesus is here with me in my failing.
Right.
And you know, like, you know, yeah, we talk about this carving out holy time versus making it known that all time is something that God has a reign over.
Yeah. Yeah,
I think about some of the words that were not so great on this list of like tense, crowded, messy, secretive, in crisis, sad. Like if your home feels like that, there is nothing wrong with admitting that.
Right.
And recognizing that Jesus is still there, that and that he still is present, and that when you unpack that, our home is in crisis. I do need
yeah.
help.
Mm-hmm.
We are feeling sad. And when you unpack and open up that door, like that is honoring to God. That mm-hmm. is what Jesus wants to be a part of. Like he wants to be in the mess. He doesn't just want you to be faking that your house is welcoming and perfect
right.
and lovely. Or that you don't care. Maybe you really do care that your house is an absolute pit and it really does frustrate you.
Yeah,
you
sure.
don't
yeah.
want people
absolutely.
To come over.
Right. And you want people in your life and then by proxy as parents, you want people in your kids' life
mm-hmm.
who get that.
Yeah.
Like when you were talking just then, I kind of got a little choked up thinking about like how that role is what school has been for my kids, right?
Mm.
Like Trinity and Concordia, you know, those high schools that they're intentional with sharing Jesus with your kids when they are broken
yeah.
and sad and mm-hmm. in crisis and
yeah.
all of those things, like kind of that's what you want as a parent, is that you've surrounded your kids with that kind of, not all the top of that list, right?
Right.
Like, it's easy to surround your kids with people who are comforting and loving mm-hmm. and nurturing.
And to hide away or push into the closets all of
right.
the other.
But sometimes right. it's hard for us to model and show our kids to be in crisis with others, you
yeah.
know, is to show that, hey, I'm in a bad place or I'm struggling, that because, word, you
because
know?
They're going to be in crisis.
Oh, yeah.
They're going to be sad.
For sure.
There are going to be secrets. Yeah. There's going to be, you know, tense. There's going to be all of these moments.
Right.
But if we never model how to walk through those with Jesus
right.
or how to walk through those vulnerably.
Healthfully.
Yeah, healthy. Yeah.
And I think
just
that's probably,
to admit it.
Right.
You know?
And I think that's probably something that, like, very young parents don't often even get told or talked. It's
sure.
not something yeah. often talked about, how important that is to say, here's problems, there's conflict, there's it's
yeah.
we embrace it, we don't avoid it.
It makes me think of sticky faith, you know, where we talk about intergenerational
yeah.
relationships.
Right.
Like, yes, you need to know that when it's good, Jesus is there. When it's bad, Jesus is there.
Mm-hmm.
That when you feel like nobody understands, Jesus is there. When you're welcoming people into your heart, Jesus is there. When you are opening your heart to say, I messed up, and, you know, family, I need your forgiveness, or friends, I need your forgiveness. Like, he's there. He's there, and he wants to be part of all of it, not just some sort of mask that we put on to make it seem like he's present
right.
in our lives.
Right.
Like, if we don't model that for our kids or for the people that we invite into our homes, then we're missing it.
And I also think, so because our households, our lives go through these ups and downs
mm-hmm.
times, right? When your household happens to be at a time
mm-hmm.
when, okay, yeah, we are a comfortable, loving place, we need to be willing to go to those households that are not.
Mm.
And not just stay inside our
yeah.
little hole.
And
but
also
go
invite those households.
Into
right?
other places.
Oh, sure.
And
yeah.
Yes, and to bring them
mm-hmm.
alongside. But also to let them know that, you know what, I am willing to come into the ugly and the mess with you too.
Oh, yeah.
Because
right.
I've been there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's something to be said about that, because we, being open and
yeah.
honest and willing to share, you know,
and I think
we're not
to,
alone.
We have to honestly be able to do that as Christians, because I think to some extent it's easier for us to say we're willing to do that. But then when the rubber hits the road, I mean, I'm sure Tracy's experienced it, because I've experienced it. When you get that parent that emails something along the lines of, I heard a kid said this at at grow group or at
camp.
Whatever, at camp or something, you know, and it's like,
yeah,
because
they
they're
did.
A kid.
Yeah.
Mm. Like, you know, their real life actually exists.
Yeah.
And to kind of summarize this whole conversation, I heard it on a podcast recently. When will we allow each other to be human?
Mm.
And rather right. than expecting everybody to be God.
I yep. still get shocked looks when I tell middle schoolers that I've cussed. I'm like, come on, guys.
Well, or
it's
or
a
like
shocker
in high school.
To some kids yeah. when they realize they're leaders, adults, they're, you know, principals,
parents,
and in my case,
pastors.
Parents, pastors have these moments of frustration and
oh, yeah.
sadness and bitterness and
giving into temptation.
Right.
And, yeah.
It's like, and I'm just so honest about it, because I want kids to know that you are messy and your people came before you were messy, and
mm-hmm.
it's just all part of our journey. And
it's so funny to me. So, like, walking through the confirmation program, I had a student who went ahead and did a check-in, even though they haven't received the
mm-hmm.
unit. I was like, oh, that's cute. Yeah. And but one of the questions of the unit check-in that they went ahead on this year was something about, like, why is there no such thing as a good person,
mm.
you know?
Mm.
And they naturally, because of the world that we live in, that question rubbed them the wrong way.
Ah.
Like, what do you mean you're trying to tell me there's no such thing as a good person? Like, I get it that we all sin, but,
mm.
you know.
But
that,
generally, I'm pretty good, yeah.
Right,
yeah.
exactly. But I
yeah.
I love how, like, the show The Good Place actually brought this out. I was my sister recommended
one.
It to me.
Yeah.
I was like, when I originally saw it, I was like, I'm not going to watch this, whatever, because, like, they got to be making fun of heaven or something like that.
Right.
And they do wrestle with, I mean, the whole premise is, the good place is heaven, the bad place is hell, things like that.
Right.
But when, as you watch this show through the seasons and stuff like that, you realize that they are really challenging that notion that anyone is good. Yeah. You know, it's a very biblical perspective
about
how difficult it is to actually call anyone good, especially for us if theologically you understand that any sin taints the whole bunch as it did to all of creation. So it's a level of like, let's be human, guys. Let's treat each other like humans too. And as we look at this chapter, and that's where even your households are allowed to be human. Mm-hmm. They're allowed to be real. They're allowed to mess up. They're allowed to be messy. Yep. And I think the refreshing piece is a lot of the conversations we've had are actually previews of what the end of the book is going to be.
Oh, whoops.
Of what messy prayers are going to sound like, of what loud tables are going to sound like, and what open doors particular. Because I know some people are out there listening going, you talked a lot about people coming into my house. What are you trying to do? But find this encouragement. Again, what I love about this book, what you'll find as we step into some of those first chapters is they're going to give you, this is a baby step. Mm-hmm. This is the next step. And this is what full throttle looks like. And I think the scary part is we think full throttle open doors, but they actually introduce what does it look like to crack your door open? And then what does it look like for something a little bit more than that maybe too? But ultimately this chapter and kind of what at least my big takeaway is just the mundane matters. Like every moment you get with people, because again, I like how you pointed out, I'm the single guy in the room, but like for single people too, every moment you get is a moment God can and will use, because God is with you, not just when you're at church at a certain hour, but at every moment of your day, he is with you. I will be with you always to the very end of the age. So big takeaways for you guys as you look at this chapter and seeing how even the boring parts matter to God, what are you taking away?
For me, it's like just the repetitious stuff that happens in our house. So, you know, my kids bickering over something and me saying, try again, you know, or, or, you know, let's try that again with respect, or, you know, like that is good. That even, you know, even though if you were to put a microphone in, you'd be like, man, they do not have their stuff together. Like, even when it's hitting the fan, or even when I lose my temper, when 20 minutes later, I recognize that this moment is important and I come back into the room and I apologize to my kids, that's good. That's progress. Mm-hmm. So the mundane matters, and even in the failings or your perceived failings, it's actually opportunities to teach your kids about how Christianity functions or how it should function, that there are mistakes, that there's forgiveness, that there's newness granted, you know, that like we just process together and we recognize nobody is perfect except Jesus, and that's why we trust him so much.
Absolutely.
Yeah, for me, I felt like my biggest takeaway was just that idea of opening your doors and how hard that can be. Maybe for people in my place in life where your kids are gone. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know that I still have all the occasions to have people over at my house. Mm-hmm. I need my new occasions, right? Mm-hmm. Because when I looked on those list of things, I did all of that when my kids were little. We had guests, we had Bible studies in our home, we did confirmation. We were like that family that was like, oh, sure, everybody can come over. Sure, all in. But now here I am in my first year as an empty nester, and I'm like, I don't think anybody's come over this year, like other than my family. You know, I don't think I've had an event where people came and sat and ate and hung around my house with me. And so I think for me, that just reminded me that even when you don't have kids in your home still, that you still need that vibrancy in your home. And I got to figure that out, I think.
I love that it challenged you that way. And I'm sure we'll get into it even more. But even myself reading this book in June of 2020 was like, you're a single guy. Like, what are you going to do? And that's where it was like, I know I was already hosting my girl group beforehand. But like, I really, no matter how much I was trying to convince myself, oh, I really don't want to do this week. Should I pass off hosting to somebody else? It was a no. Like, for your own spiritual vibrancy, you need this to come in and see your crazy boxer and things like that, which is a dog. Yeah. People don't know. My dog is a boxer.
And he's super sweet and loves to love on people.
But it's messy. It's loud and things like that. And I prep everybody. I was like, I got a crazy boxer dog, so get ready for that.
Get ready.
Yeah. And I think for me, just life. Life happening in my house, the good, the bad, the ugly, it's all important. Yep. And it's where all God's plan for, you know, it's all important.
Yeah. My quote, right? My quote that's standing out to me as we wrap this up: how I spend this ordinary day in Christ is how I will spend my Christian life. Mm-hmm. Every day matters. Every moment matters. And again, that's not to...
It's not to guilt or to add pressure.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. It's to actually free you up. Yep. Like that God's a part of every bit of that mess. And he embraces it. And we're going to see that even closer as we look into the next chapter, which is Unpacking How the Bible Sees Our Homes. Easily my favorite chapter of the entire book, but that's because I love the Bible so much. I love scripture. And this will rock your socks. You're going to have to listen next week because it blows your mind when you really look at how much you've missed over your lifetime of what the Bible has to say about households. Like this, it's just incredible, the deep dive that they give us. And I'm looking forward to it. And because again, it did that to me. And maybe some of you guys already knew all this stuff. I did not. So like I was recognized all the stuff that I missed. And in this chapter kind of introduced it to when they kind of introduced Joshua at the end and said, did you know that when Joshua said, as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. He wasn't talking about his wife and kids. And I was like, oh, okay, let's dive into that.
Because it's so often used in that setting of
that we all have that sign, right? Right. Or,
So we'll get to deep dive into that a little bit more. Next time, in the meantime, find us on Facebook, Raise Them Up Podcast. Make sure you include podcast. Raise Them Up will give you something else. And email, if you'd like to email us any questions you have, engage in conversations about this one, you can email us at raisethemup@trinitycline.org. That's raise E-M. UP at trinitycline.org. And we'll see you next time.